Yeah, you just play the chords. He does the little diddly. We had to. It was just confusing for. But yeah, ready? Oh, we can't go. Really? It's time. Hey, there's people. If you begin to find your seats this evening, let's sing that song, How Awesome is the Lord. Great are you, Lord, as we clap today. Great are you, Lord, mighty in strength. You are faithful, you will ever be. We will praise you. Your hands, all you nations, shout to God, all creation. How awesome is the Lord Most High. When you send us, when you send us, God, we will go. You're the answer we want the world to know. We will trust you. When you call our names, when you lead us, we'll follow all the way. Raise your hands, all you nations, shout to God, all creation. How awesome is the Lord Most High. We will praise you together. Stand in this place as we sing Holy is the Lord, as we clap this evening. We stand and lift up our hands.
We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is the strength. We bow down, worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He. Together we sing, everyone sing, holy is the Lord, and holy is the Lord, God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory, holy is the Lord, God Almighty. The
that song, Nothing's Too Hard. Oh, you are the God of heaven and earth as we clap to you. You are the God of heaven and earth. You are the King of the whole universe. You move the mountains, you calm the seas. You hold my life in the palm of your hands. Nothing's too hard, oh, nothing's too hard. Jesus, there's nothing too hard for you. Nothing's too hard, nothing's too hard. Jesus, there's nothing too hard. You are the God, you are the God of heaven and earth. You are the King of the whole universe. You move the mountains, you calm the seas. You hold my life in the palm of your hands. The sun and the sun, the moon, the wind, the stars, they're all in the power of your hand. Nothing's too hard, oh, nothing's too hard. Jesus, there's nothing too hard for you. Nothing's too hard, nothing's too hard. Jesus, there's nothing too hard. The mountains tremble. The mountains tremble at the sound of your name. The oceans flee by the power of your word. Every tongue, every tribe shall confess you are God of everything. Everything. Nothing's too hard. Oh, nothing's too hard. Jesus, there's nothing too hard for you. Oh, nothing's too hard. Nothing's too hard. Jesus, there's nothing too hard for you. There's nothing too hard for you. Amen. Let's sing that song to the ends of the earth. Oh, love unfailing. Love unfailing, overtaking my heart. You take me in, finding peace again. Fear is lost in all you are. And I will give, and I will give the world to tell your story. I know that you've called me. I know that you've called me. I've lost myself for good within your promise, and I won't hide it. I won't hide it. Jesus, I believe in you, and I would go to the ends of the earth, to the ends of the earth. For you alone are the Son of God, and all the world will see that you are God, that you are God. Oh, love unfailing, love unfailing. Overtaking my heart, you take me in, finding peace again. Fear is lost in all you are. I will give, and I will give the world to tell your story, 'cause I know that you've called. Know that you've called me.
Let's give God praise in this place. Father God, we thank you for your grace and for your love. We know that you are able to do all things. Change our hearts tonight, God. Cause us to recognize you as the living God. I ask, Lord God, that you would come down and inhabit the praises of your people this evening. We want to open up our service in corporate prayer. There are many needs that we want to bring before God. We're asking God to get involved. And in our circumstances, there are areas of need and for healing, salvation, for loved ones. We're lifting up our churches and many events that are upcoming, and we want to pray God's hand of protection in our lives. And we're continuing to pray for the pastoral staff, the council in this church, that God will provide wisdom, direction, and guidance, that God will give us insight and knowledge to know what we're supposed to do. We're asking for continued healing in the lives of Edgar Vargas and Lou Olagi, praying for John Kern, Floyd Drennan, and Brad Ratowski. We're asking God will do a miracle in their lives in the area of cancer as they're undergoing treatment. We want to pray strength and supernatural healing. We want to continue to pray for the nation of America, that God will open doors of opportunity for evangelism, that we can get the gospel message out while there is still time. There are lives that are slipping into eternity. There are people in groups that need Christ. We're asking God will give us favor in schools to preach the gospel. We want to pray for many of the needs that are on the screens behind us, lifting them up by name, specifically joining together, asking God to move in their circumstances and in their need. And we want to pray for our service tonight, special anointing upon Pastor Greg as he brings a word from heaven that God is going to minister to every single individual in this place tonight. Amen. How many of you have a need? You want to bring that before God and ask God. He knows what that is. Let's lift that up and in prayer. Let's believe God for his help. And we're going to ask Brother Kota to come and open us in prayer this evening. Father God, we thank you for who you are and what you are able to do. We know that you respond to prayer. God, we know that there are circumstances that are outside our ability to control. But through prayer, we can touch the throne of grace. Incline your ear. God, your arm is not short, nor your ear heavy. God, you are able, Lord, to respond in a mighty way. God, loved ones that are lost, those that are sick in their body, God, we're asking that you would touch them, that you would bring revival, Lord God. Help us to be a part of bringing in the harvest that you have called us to do, Lord.
Oh, Father God, tonight we give you thanks for the opportunity that you give us to be here. We ask you, Father God, for your blessing. I ask you for every need, every petition that these people bring to you, bring miracles on the supernatural, Father God. I ask you for every pastor, bless them. I ask you for Pastor Greg, give him wisdom, give him anointing in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Praise God. You can be seated this evening. We want to welcome you out. Thank you for joining us here tonight, especially if you're a visitor. We want to say thank you and welcome to the Potter's House tonight. And if you're joining us online, welcome. We're believing God is going to minister in a mighty way and touch you, no matter where you are at this evening or what time you're watching this. And we're going to believe God for that. And a couple of announcements before we begin our service. Saturday, outreach is going to be taking place at the 180 facility at 10:30. So we want to encourage you to come and support that and bring the message of the gospel to our Tri-City area. Also, we want to remember there is going to be a men's breakfast that is coming up on this Saturday. We want to invite you all out to that. If you plan to attend, it would be very helpful if you would sign up so we know how many to feed, and encourage you to bring visitors and let people know our brother Anthony Cassio is going to be bringing a word from God before his departure. So come out and support that, and let's believe God for souls to be saved and lives to be touched. Also, the marriage retreat is coming up, and there are sign-up sheets for that. We want to make certain, if you could, scan that QR code as soon as possible if you plan to go, so we can make room reservations and accommodations for that event. And then exciting announcement as well, this Saturday we'll be having another youth takeover. So all the teens are rising up. They're going to be leading the dramas and the bands and the testimonies, and we're going to not only believe God for a miracle, but we're going to come out and support them, evangelize, let people in the area know what is going on this Saturday at 7 o'clock. You come and be a part of that. Amen. If we could have our ushers come, We're going to take up the offering of the evening. A 27-year-old Devin Sylvie sold his car, and he decided to do something very special with the money, and he took it to his mother's house, where he placed it inside a Mickey Mouse tumbler inside of the cabinet. It had been there for 15 years. It was never used. He figured this would be a safe place. You know what's coming. He returned a couple of days later to find that that Mickey Mouse container was gone. His mother had collected that along with a bunch of other junk and taken it to the Goodwill, where that thing had been promptly sold, apparently without people ever opening or checking the contents of the mug. Out $6,500. The moral of the story is not be a Mickey Mouse junk collector, all right, and hope for the best at Goodwill. The moral of the story is it matters where you place your money and your resources. We read Apostle Paul talking to the Corinthian church in 1 Corinthians 16, 1 and 2. Now I write to you about the collection of money for God's people. Do the same thing that I told the Galatian church to do. On the first day of every week, each one of you should put aside money as you have been blessed. Paul instructs the churches and instructs us today that a portion of our income is to be poured not into Mickey Mouse cups, but into earthen vessels, into souls, and into others. Bible says, store up for yourselves treasure in earthen vessels. This is the opportunity to have the heart that God has as his followers, as his believers. God's concern is for souls. It is for others. And as we come into the house of God, we have the opportunity to worship, but also to take a portion of our income, a tithe, the tenth, and offerings besides, and we're able to put it into the lives of others. We're able to touch people around the world to save souls as you and I partake and invest in evangelism. Let's give tonight. I'm going to ask our brother Bill Hunt if you would bless the gift and the giver.
Amen. Let's sing that song. Hallelujah, the Lord reigns.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Thank you, musicians and workers. I appreciate your help. Good evening. I want to thank you all for praying. Some of you are wondering if I died, and I did not. Fortunately, last week I had surgery on my eyes, and then the same day I came down with a horrible sinus infection, sounded like a frog for a few days, and laid in bed for days and days. But I'm finally feeling alive, and so I'm going to preach tonight. By the grace of God, I'm going to preach both services on Sunday as well. So thank you for praying for me. And I had your prayers, antibiotics, and I practiced therapeutic moaning as well. And that's, my wife doesn't believe in it, but I lay in bed and moan and whine. I feel much better when I do it. It's medicinal. I just can't convince my wife of that, but it works for me. So here I am. And I had surgery, and it will take some time for my eyes to see clearly. So I've printed out my sermon in 19 font. They didn't have Braille, or I would have tried that. So, amen. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Psalm chapter 98. Psalm chapter 98 is where we're going to go. 9-year-old boy named Ronan Mateen, his grandparents took him to the orchestra for the very first time. So he had never seen a performance like this. In the middle of the performance, they paused for a moment and it was quiet, and the boy burst out and said, "Wow!" And everyone in the concert, they burst out laughing, and then they started clapping. Orchestra CEO said, "It's one of the most wonderful moments I've experienced in the concert hall." The orchestra they reached out to the grandparents and asked them to come and meet with them. They thought they were in trouble, but in fact, they gave him a special performance, allowed this boy to be in a dress rehearsal of a Mozart celebration. They've dubbed Ronan the Wow Child. And when he was watching the second performance, he didn't say much, but his grandmother said he was tapping the window and jumping up and down. Artistic director Harry Christopher said that Mateen's exuberance puts his job in perspective. He said, "With these sort of moments make us realize exactly what we're here for and what we're doing. With Ronan, it's spontaneous. It's an innocence. It's just lovely." Here's the point of the story. Ronan had a new experience, and he just had to respond to it. In the text that we're going to read, we are commanded to sing new songs. New songs. Every believer, God wants you to sing new songs. And what that has to do with is the fact that our relationship with God must be present tense. Any disciples that you want to preach one day, I'm often asked, where do sermons come from? Sometimes this is just my Bible reading. But when I come across things I don't understand, I write them down and go back. One of these, I've read this for years about new songs, and the thought occurred to me, what exactly is a new song? And so I began to study, and that's where this sermon came from. Let's read Psalm 98, 1 through 3. I want to preach about new songs. Psalm 98, 1 through 3. "Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have gained him the victory. The Lord has made known his salvation, his righteousness. He has revealed in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his mercy and his faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God." New songs. I want to begin. Let's talk about the blessings and the danger of the past. Let's gain a history for a moment. I'm laying a foundation before we get actually into new songs. The Bible is a record of God's help and blessings in the past. Verse 1 and 2, these are all past tense. "He has done marvelous things. His right hand and holy arm have gained him the victory. The Lord has made known his salvation, his righteousness he has revealed in the sight of the nations." All of those are in the past, because the Bible records things that God has done in the past. God has done good things for us corporately. That means as a group. 1 Samuel 7, 12, Samuel anoints, erects an altar, and this stone, he calls it Ebenezer because he says, "Up till now, the Lord has helped us." This is as a group. In our church, God has done great things. We've seen wonderful conversions. Disciples have been made. We've seen God's financial blessings that God has released in our congregation. Our fellowship, we just finished the memorial stones talking about the impact that God has enabled our fellowship to make in the entire world. And so that is a corporate thing that God has done. God has done things for us individually. Genesis 16, 13, Hagar said, she called the name of the Lord who spoke to her, "You are the God who sees," because she said, "Have I also here seeing him who sees me. This is amazing to her. She had heard about the God of Abraham, but she said, God sees me. Now I have an experience with God. Psalm 68 to 19, blessed be the Lord who daily loads us with benefits, the God of our salvation. So the record of the past must be remembered. We have to deliberately remember the past. And the word remember, it means to hold in the mind, to not let go of, or don't let it slip. Psalm 77:11, I will remember the works of the Lord. Surely I will remember your wonders of old. So how do we remember the good things that God has done corporately, the things that God has done individually? We have to personally ponder or list God's blessings. I think at Thanksgiving, I preached from Psalm 103, and I pointed out that that psalm is a list of benefits and blessings from God. We remember what God has done in prayer and in praise. When you praise God, or when you get down to pray, one of the things that should happen, you should rehearse to yourself between you and God. I remember what you have done. I thank you for what you have done. And then we remember by telling other people. The demoniac of the Gadarene, Jesus said, go and tell your family what God has done. And so when you do that, I'm still only talking about the past, has practical benefits. It produces gratitude. It reminds you of what you should be. It encourages you in current difficulties. There have been times in my life when maybe, whether that's personally or whether that is in the fellowship or the church, facing large problems. At times, my wife has reminded me, Greg, has God helped us in the past? Yes, then he's going to help us again, because that's what it does when you remember the past. It encourages you in current difficulties. And then finally, it enables. When you remember the past, when you rehearse, you train new people in the goodness of God, whether that is your children. Your children need to hear you say good things about God. Your children need to hear your testimony of what God has done for you. New converts need to hear older people and people have been saved longer talk about the things of God. So all of this is simply the past, and the past is wonderful. Here is the problem. Some people, all they have is the past. They only have a past tense relationship with God. If you hear them talk about their salvation, they will tell you about, I used to be so on fire. Oh man, when I first got saved, I witnessed to everything that moved. I used to be so involved. I was involved in ministry every night of the week. I was doing great things for God. But that's not current. That is what you used to be. And they're no longer doing that today. You know, some people say, I've been saved for 20 years, whatever the number is. But if we want to get technical, some people haven't been saved for 20 years. They've been saved 1 year 20 times. Right? That's not the same. In other words, all they have is the past. And they never move on into any new areas. They never move on into any new levels in their relationship with God. Judges 5:17 in the Amplified Version said, Gilead remained beyond the Jordan. Why did Dan stay with the ships? Asher sat still on the seacoast and remained by his creeks. These did not come forth to battle for God's people. Here at a crucial moment, there were people who stayed where it was easy. They stayed where it was safe. They stayed where it was familiar. And so what we're talking about is some people, their relationship with God is only past tense what God has done. Colossians 4:17, say to Archippus, take heed to the ministry you've received in the Lord, that you may fulfill it. Here's a man who apparently had a calling. There were things that God wanted him to do, and Paul writes this letter, and he's so moved. He says, say to this man, fulfill it. You are not doing what you're supposed to be doing now. Probably the fact that he was named meant that he had done some good things, but it was only in the past. Man went to see his doctor, and the doctor said, if you want what's best for you, you need to diet, eat healthy foods, lose weight, and exercise. The man thought for a minute, and he said, if you want what's best, he said, what's second best? And it's possible that our relationship with God can be second best because you have a past that was very good, but that is not what we're supposed to have alone. See, past tense relationship with God is unsatisfying. Relationship with God in the Old Testament had a visible picture. It was called manna. Every day there was this food that would appear, daily bread. Be like reading your Bible. That would be a daily bread for you and I. But one of the things about this manna, this daily bread, is if you held on to it, it bred worms and it started to stink. It was never meant to be past tense. It was meant to be fresh and daily. And in fact, not only is it unsatisfying to have a past tense relationship with God, past tense relationship can actually be dangerous for us. Because we assume, because I was doing God's will at one point, that means I'm still doing that today. Revelations 3:17, Jesus said to the church in Laodicea, you say, I'm rich, I have everything I want, I don't need a thing. And you don't realize you're wretched, miserable, poor, and blind and naked. Years ago when it was in the era where I began to pray for the sick. I was not pastoring in Prescott. I actually met Dad in Los Angeles. And we went and visited Angelus Temple. Angelus Temple is the huge building built by Amy Semple McPherson, the founder of the Foursquare Gospel Church. She had an incredible miracle ministry, and this building was so interesting when you went in, because along the walls, and this is a massive building, I don't know how many thousands of people it seats, but along the walls they had hung up crutches and braces and wheelchairs, that these people were powerfully healed. I don't need the crutch anymore. I don't need the brace anymore. I don't need the wheelchair anymore. And so Angelus Temple was a shrine to healing power. Now, I had been praying for the sick for not too many years. I am in awe. Just look at all of the record of healing. But my father said something to me that was awesome. He said, but the shame is they're not doing it today. It's what God was doing in the 20s. It's what God was doing in the 1930s or 40s. But they're not doing it today, past tense. So now this brings us in our text. Let's talk about singing new songs. Our text commands us to sing new songs to the Lord. Verse 1, oh, sing to the Lord a new song. As I said, I've read this. I've been saved 45 years. Only the Lord knows how many times I've read this, heard this. And I began to ask, what is a new song? I began to study this. In the Old Testament, new songs were songs that were sung as a response to some new work of God in redemption. When God would do something that people had not experienced before, they would sing. You know, the first song recorded in the Bible is found in Exodus 15. They may have sung before, but the first one that was written down or recorded is Exodus 15. 1 and 2, then Moses and the children of Israel sang this song to the Lord. And they spoke, saying, I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and its rider he has thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and song, and he's become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him, my Father's God, and I will exalt him. So a new song, this doesn't, it's not that the song is new, meaning the music. We've never heard this music before, or even the words we've never heard before. But it's an experience that is new, and they sing about it. Exodus 15, here's the first song. Something incredible happened. They were delivered from slavery in Egypt. They are trapped now, the Red Sea in front of them, mountains to the side. The army is chasing them to kill them or to take them back to slavery. And as they cry out to God, the waters open up like walls on either side. They walk through on dry, it wasn't even muddy, on dry ground. And when the last of God's people had gone through the water, when the Egyptians tried going through the walls of water, it closed up and they never had problems with Pharaoh again. So they had never seen anything like that. They memorialized it. They sang. They were so excited. Can you believe the horse and the our enemies? God took care of it. He saved it. They did that to worship and celebrate and remember. Our text, Psalm 98, is one of five times in the Bible that we are commanded to sing a new song to the Lord. You know, in the book of Revelation, here's the end. God is allowing us to see into heaven. Revelation gives us a glimpse of what's going to be going on in heaven. Revelations 5, 9, and 10, and they sang a new song, saying, you are worthy to take the scroll, open its seals, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe and tongue, people and nation. You have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign on the earth. Here is in heaven, they're singing a new song. Here God does something that they had not seen before, the opening of the scrolls that are connected to redemption. And once again, they sing about it. They respond to the work that God is doing. And so five times in the Bible, like we read in Psalm 98, God says to you, to me, to all of us, every believer, sing to the Lord a new song. By all means, have the old songs. By all means, sing about what the Lord has done corporately and individually. But God says, make sure you sing new songs. See, Christianity, relationship with God, is meant to be present tense. It is meant to be what God is doing now in our lives, in our church, and in our fellowship. Exodus 3:14, Moses is asking God, you want me to go speak on your behalf? If they ask me, what is God's name? What do I tell them? And God said, you tell them, I am who I am. Thus shall you say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you. He doesn't say, tell them I was. Don't just tell them, well, who I used to be. You tell them I am right now, up to date, because that is the character of God. Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. See, I can tell you what God has done for me personally 45 years ago when God saved me. I can tell you through the years of salvation and ministry, things God has done in the past, but I can also tell you what God is doing this year, what God is doing right now, because my relationship with God is meant to be present tense. I'm not just going to tell you what God did in 1978 when he saved me. My relationship must be 2024, so I can sing new songs. Matthew 13:52, every teacher of religious law who has become a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like a homeowner who brings from his storeroom new gems of truth as well as old. That is a healthy relationship with God. Some people, this is why I did memorial stones. There are some that they want to get rid of the old. Everything, God is doing a new thing, a new thing. And you have to have the old. But some people, all they have is the old. They have nothing new. And Jesus said, a wise homeowner, if you're wise in relationship with God, you have both new and old. The Bible tells us, Judges chapter 6, of a man named Gideon. Gideon had a secondhand experience with God. He knew what God had done in the nation in the past. He has something that most of us have never experienced. God himself, the angel of the Lord, which is an Old Testament appearance of God you could see with your eyes. God shows up in front of Gideon, and when he sees God and hears it as God, he says, well, if God's on our side, how come you're not doing what I hear you used to do for us? And the response of God is, have I not sent you? In other words, he is telling Gideon, you can experience this today. Yes, it's wonderful what God did for the nation in the past, but you can make that real for you. There are some of you, you're young, you've been raised in church, you've heard stories, you hear people talk about what God has done for them. You can have that today. And every person must have a present tense relationship with God. 2 Kings 2:13 and 14, Elisha picked up Elisha's cloak or mantle, which had fallen when he was taken up to heaven. Then Elisha returned to the bank of the Jordan River. He struck the water with Elijah's cloak, and he cried out, where is the Lord, the God of Elijah? And the river divided. Elisha went across. He knew what God had done through his pastor. He had seen his pastor perform miracles. But now he puts it to the test. I have to have that at work today in my life. Where is the God of Elijah? And it became present tense. When you have a present tense relationship with God, Christianity is meant to be a life of worship. Sing. Don't just have new experiences. Have new songs. Because Christianity is meant to be a life of worship. Whenever you experience God in new ways, then it is you should worship God based on that new experience. You know, I feel sorry for people who come to church and they never worship God. They don't sing, they don't clap, they just kind of look around, apparently waiting for service to be over. I feel sorry for them. But then no wonder they have nothing new going on in their life. No wonder they don't want to sing. But when God is real and present tense, you want to sing. You want to say something about it. Psalm 100, verse 1 and 2, shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him singing with joy. I was struck when I read that article of that boy, Ronan Mateen, who, when faced with a new experience of an orchestra, the beautiful music, his response being 9 years old was wow. I've told before when Lisa and I were in South Africa, pastoring, had a new convert. A policeman came in and got saved. He was one of only two white people I ever had saved in South Africa the whole time we were there. He was a raw sinner, which is a rarity. Most South Africans had religious background. They knew the Bible. They knew the terms, even though they didn't live it. Not this guy. This guy was just a raw sinner. Everything was new. I came to church. If I remember right, it was probably a Wednesday night. I had a sermon. I wasn't terribly excited about it, but it was mine. I had worked on it. To me, it was basic things I had heard many times before. My new convert, who had no background in anything of Christianity, was sitting on the front row, and I began to preach. And in the first point, I simply talked about the love of God. And I said, imagine the God of the universe loves us. He wants to have relationship with you. And on the front row, this guy went, wow. It's like, he didn't know you're not supposed to wow in church, like clearly. Kind of took me aback a bit. Like, but I went on preaching. Point two, and I said, and the God of the universe who loves you, he has a plan for your life. And he said, wow. And he's looking around like he's excited. I mean, like everybody should be going, wow. With, I want to tell you, by the end of the sermon, I was getting excited. Like, this is good. Because it was new, it was fresh, and he couldn't contain himself. This is what God wants. He wants us to sing new songs. Let's talk finally about the power of new songs. New songs, the reason why God wants you to sing new songs, not only because it's correct, it's healthy for God's people. When you are experiencing God in new and fresh ways, that means the life of God is flowing through you. John 7:38, he who believes in me, as the scripture said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. That is what relationship with God is meant to be. It is meant to flow. Ezekiel 47, he brought me to the back door of the temple, and there was water flowing from under the threshold of the temple toward the east. This is what real healthy Christianity is meant to be, flow. Life comes in, life flows out. That is healthy. Proverbs 11:25, the generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters out will be watered in himself. You know what? Christianity is much more enjoyable when you are seeing God at work in the present tense. There have been times in my life where I went to church and I really would rather not be there. I didn't want to go to hell, but I wasn't particularly excited about being there. That's a horrible way to live. Church, have you ever noticed that? Time is relative, isn't it? For some people, this is the longest service that has ever been in the history of man, because you don't want to be here in the first place. But all, when you have a present tense, when God is making himself real, how healthy, how different everything is. Christianity is meant to be present tense. New songs, biblically, they trigger a response from God. You know what's interesting is in the Bible, when God's people worship him based on who he is, what he's done in the past, it triggers a new work of God on their behalf, which then gives them new reasons to worship and sing new songs. Think about Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas are arrested. They're beaten. They're thrown in prison. Their hands and feet, they're locked into the stocks. And the Bible says, at midnight, they began to sing. You know, worship is not meant to be, I feel great, so I'm going to sing a song. They're in pain, they're arrested, they're mistreated, but they begin to sing about how good God is. And the Bible says an earthquake happens. The locks open, the chains fall off, doors open. And out of that, the Philippian jailer comes to salvation. So think about this. Their singing triggered a response from God. I bet that they sang new songs about, they had a new song to sing. Silas, let's sing that one about God opening up the prison doors. Because when you worship, there's something healthy in you, but it's also healthy for you because it causes God, the Bible says God inhabits the praises of his people. When you live not only just in church, when you live a life of praise, God wants to be with you. You ever been with someone sour and cranky? You ever been with someone, they're grumpy, they're one of the seven dwarfs, they're grumpy. You don't want to be around them. It's like, yeah, I gotta go, I got a thing. You know, fun to be around. But there's someone when they have a sweet spirit, there's something you want to be near them when they're happy. That's how God is as well. When there are people that they have a present tense relationship, people who their instinct of their heart is to tell God, God, I love, thank you. It's incredible that we get to be involved in this. God says, I like them. I want to be with them. 2 Chronicles 20:22, when they began to sing, to praise the Lord, set ambushes against the people of Ammon, Moab, Mount Seir, who came against them, and the enemies were defeated. Finally, new songs form a testimony to the world. Verse 3 in our text, all the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. There's something powerful about when an unbeliever hears of the goodness of God and sees the good things that God is doing. Acts 3:8-10, the lame man leapt, stood and walked and entered the temple, walking, leaping, praising God. All the people saw him walking and praising God. They knew he was the one who used to sit begging for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. They were filled with wonder and amazement at what happened to him. You know, I've heard sinners, unbelievers, when they hear a Christian talk about how good God is and what he's done to them, I've heard him say these words, you talk like God is real to you. Yeah, that's exactly right. Because that's what it's meant to do. It's meant to be a testimony to the nation. Psalm 126:1-2. When the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Then our mouth was filled with laughter, our tongue with singing. Then they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. Mark Olson told me this story. You know, Mark and Michelle went to Davao City in the Philippines. At the time when they went, there was a communist insurgency. The communists were trying to take over. And in Davao City, the communists, a very common tactic is when they saw a crowd of people, they would go to churches, political rallies, anywhere people were gathered, the communists often would throw hand grenades into the crowd as a terror tactic to kill, to maim people. They were doing a crusade. This is outside now. And three communist insurgents came and they were looking for a place to commit an act of terror, and they saw a crowd, which is perfect. It's Pastor Mark Olson preaching to the crowd, but they heard music. And they liked music, so they thought, before we throw the grenades, let's go listen to the music. And they came down in the crowd, and back in those days, you know what happened in the service, is take the hand of the person next to you. So the people on either side grabbed their hands. So because their hands were held, they couldn't grab the grenades. So they sat there listening, and there was singing going on, and they sat down. Mark Olson preached the gospel of Jesus Christ. They heard the preaching, and it gave a challenge to come down if you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, if you want to experience God as your Savior. And so these three communist terrorists answered the altar call. As they answered the altar call, Pastor Mark Olson, who would have been prime terrorist target, an American in the Philippines, he went down the line of the people that got saved and he laid hands on them. One of these men said later, the American didn't know that underneath my shirt was a hand grenade. And when he put his hand on my head, he didn't know the only thing between him and death was the pin of a grenade. But the singing captured their attention. And when they were drawn, because God's people were singing, I'm so glad Jesus set me free, they were captivated. And the singing is what saved Mark Olson. The singing is what saved them ultimately, because the Bible says, if you are a believer in God, sing new songs. Let's bow our heads, close our eyes. All across this place, thank God for all of you that are here. I appreciate you. Listening attentively. Now, before we do anything else in the service, there are people that are here. You don't know Jesus the way that I was describing tonight. Jesus is not real to you. I don't know whether you have a church background or no church background at all. But you don't know what it's like to feel clean on the inside, to be able to lay your head down on the pillow at night without guilt and shame. You don't know what it's like to have God at work in your life, changing you, setting you free, helping you in practical areas of your life. You don't know what it's like that the Bible comes alive and speaks to you. But you would like that. I don't know how you came tonight, but Jesus is real and he can make himself real to you tonight. I say what God said to Gideon, you can make that real in your life today. You could do it tonight. What you do is if you believe that Jesus died on the cross for your sin, and if you want to turn from your sin, God will make himself real to you as well. Just like he did for me in 1978, others in more recent times, he could make himself real to you tonight. How many people are here you don't know Jesus as your Savior? While our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed, I am giving you a challenge right now. How many people here you need God to save you? You believe that Jesus died on the cross, and if you'd be honest, God would not be pleased with the way you're living right now. You want to pray. You want God to forgive you. Tonight, if that's what you want, I want you to do one thing. Lift up your hand so I can see it. How many people here, Pastor Greg, I need Jesus. I am not right with God. I know that. Lift up your hand right now. God loves you. He wants to help you. All across this place, you want to get right with God. Some of you were saved, but you went back to sin. Backslider, lift up your hand tonight. Let God bring you back. God can help you. Thank you. I see that hand. Others, you need Jesus. Tonight's your night. This could be the night that everything changes for you. Others, you need Jesus. Lift up your hand right now. I want to get right with God. Unsaved, backslidden, let this be your night. And God will help you tonight. Amen. If you lifted your hand, you saw who that was. I want you to come. I'm going to have someone pray with you. You want to get right with God, you help them. Thank God. Being honest with God. I want you all to stand up to your feet. Sing a new song to the Lord. I'm challenging you. Your relationship with God needs to be up to date, present tense, so you can sing new songs. The altars are open. I'm inviting you to come. Talk to God. Do business while our brother sings.
All hail King Jesus. All hail Emmanuel. King of kings, Lord of lords, bright morning star. And throughout eternity, I'm going to praise Him. And forevermore, I will reign with Him.
God, make yourself real tonight, I pray, Lord God.
All hail King Jesus. All hail Emmanuel.
Hallelujah, Lord
King
God, help us now.
Lord of lords,
Father God, I need you now, Lord God.
And
oh God, I believe that you are able. God, you're going to help us. Thank you, Jesus.
And forevermore, I will reign with Him. All hail King Jesus. All hail Emmanuel. King of kings, Lord of lords, bright morning star. And throughout eternity, I'm going to forever, Lord, I will reign with him.
All hail King Jesus.
All hail King Jesus. All hail Emmanuel. King of kings, Lord of lords, bright morning star. I'm going to praise Him, and forevermore I will reign with Him.
And let's praise God together right now. Father God, we thank you. Thank you, Lord God, for salvation, Lord God. Thank you for the goodness of Calvary, Lord God. Thank you for your faithfulness that reaches to all generations. Thank God. I want to help you to pray. I want you to say this out loud. Say, Father God, make yourself real to me today. Cause life to come into me and flow through me. Give me a love for your word, for the things of God, and for your will and purpose in my life. God, I surrender to you. Bring new revelation, a new experience, and new power, and I will sing a new song. I will worship, and I will tell other people how good you are, and I thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's praise God together right now. Father God, I thank you. God, we thank and praise you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Oh, God, we are grateful for your goodness. Praise God, praise God. Amen. We're going to be dismissed. I want to encourage you. The concert, the young people are going to take that over on the weekend. Men's breakfast, that'll be the final one with Anthony. Cassio, and he's going to be the speaker at that. And that'll be this Saturday. We're going to have a great weekend. By the grace of God, I'm going to be preaching both times on both morning and night on Sunday. Thank God. Let's bow our heads and we're going to be dismissed in prayer. Please, if there's somebody you don't know, make them feel welcome. And we're going to be dismissed. And I'm asking if Jeff Brown, you dismiss in prayer. Amen. God bless you. You can be dismissed.